though your mercy never fails me, and all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, and I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, and I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, and I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. And your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life led, I surrender now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life led, I surrender now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, every breath that I need, and I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Amen. All my life you have. With my life laid, surrendered, I give you. so good. With every breath that I make, and I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Father, we're here again to celebrate corporately. Lord, Your great love for us, what You accomplished on our behalf at the cross. Lord, we're here gathering as citizens of heaven to hear Your word, to feast on the bread of heaven in the Eucharist, to experience healing and cleansing, filling, so that once again, Lord, we can go into the world and bring heaven to earth. Holy Spirit, we thank You for the encounter that each one of us are going to have with You today. Here. Thank You for the signs and wonders of Your kingdom. Thank You, Lord, for Your people who carry the gifts of the kingdom of heaven to release among the people. Lord, we thank You that You've called this place to be a church in revival, to be carriers of revival, to infect this city and other places beyond with revival. Lord, the stewardship You've given us here and throughout the Southeast and in places around the world has been about revival, oh God. May we be infectious with the Spirit of the Lord. For the sake of Your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you and forgive you all your sins to our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you with all goodness and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Let's stand and worship the Lord. Amen.
Throne on the high. is running out of an empty grave.
Name above.
would see.
Jesus, thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. You're so faithful, God. You're so faithful, Jesus. Praise you, Lord.
Generations and your family and the children and the and the children, may His presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you, within you. He is with you, He is with you in the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going.
Upon a thousand generations, you
Go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you, within you. He is with you, He is with you in the morning, in the morning, in the evening, in your coming, in your going, in your weeping, rejoicing. He is for you. give you all my praise. You alone I long to worship. You alone are worthy of my praise. I will give you all my worship.
Thank you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lift it up. Thank you, Lord. High, lift it up. High, lift it up. High, lift it up. High, lift it up. as the enemy reminds us of things that we're dealing with, facing, just in this cosmic conflict. Lord, your scripture says that you lift up our head above the battle so that we can see how you see. And remember that no matter what goes on around us, you're high and lifted up, high and lifted up, high and lifted up, high and lifted up. Lord, you're high and lifted up, high and lifted up, high and lifted up, high and lifted up. Of relationships, Lord, of changing, going on around us, things we can't control. Lord, where there's been hurt and rejection, abandonment, deep sorrow and fears, where the enemy's put shame, guilt, condemnation, where there's division, frustration, anxiety. Lord, you're high and lifted up, high and lifted up, high and lifted up, high and lifted up. Lord, you're high and lifted up, high and lifted up. High and lifted up, high and lifted up. Lord, we walk through things that we just can't see. We feel as if we're walking blindly, Lord, where there's just thick darkness, uncertainty, Lord. Your word says that even there you reign, because you're high and lifted up, high and lifted up, high and lifted up, high and lifted up. Father, where we're struggling to even believe. Lord, we're called believers, and yet believing sometimes seems to be the hardest thing that we do. We thank you that we live by the faith of the Son of God, was high and lifted up, high and lifted up, high and lifted up, high and lifted up. Lord, when there's sickness and disease, Lord, you, by your stripes, we are healed. By your wound, you were healed. You carried, you bore our sorrow, our pain, our sickness, and our grief. So in all those places, Lord, that seem so overwhelming, that are attacking our bodies and our emotions and our minds, you're high and lifted up, high and lifted up, high and lifted up, high and lifted up. Lord, you're high and lifted up, high and lifted up, high and lifted up, high and lifted up. Thank you. where there seems to be no way, you're the way. Where we don't seem to know the truth about things, Lord, you are the truth. Lord, where life seems to be so difficult, you're the life. You're the way, Lord, the truth, the life, because you're high, high and lifted up, high and lifted up, high and lifted up, high and lifted up. And Lord, because we've been seated in the heavenly places in you, out of our union with you, Lord, we're high, high and lifted up, high and lifted up, high and lifted up, high and lifted up. In you we're high, high and lifted up, high and lifted up, high and lifted up, high and lifted up. Lord, in this whole coronavirus thing, every name that is named is under your feet. The name coronavirus has been, is under your feet. Because you're high, high and lifted up, high and lifted up, high and lifted up, high and lifted up. Thank you, Lord.
You would please stand for the reading of the gospel. This is the holy gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Luke chapter 22 and verse 17. Verse 14. When the hour had come, Jesus sat down, the 12 apostles with him. Then he said to them, with fervent desire, I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say to you, I will no longer eat of it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. Then he took the cup and gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. rightly so.
Good morning. Let me find my place and set this where it won't turn off. There we go. Let's do it this way. One of the most famous Christians in church history was a man named Augustine, or some of you might know him as Augustine, but Augustine's the right name. He was from Africa, one of the great believers in church history. And he said this: "Recognize in this bread what hung on the cross, and in this cup what flowed from his side." I want to talk to you today about Eucharist. So let's pray. Claire, you want to pray for us? Amen. My intention is for this to be a one Sunday word, but it might not be. And I don't want to keep us late or get in a hurry. This could easily be a 6 month word or a year word. But I just really sense the Lord wanting us to be refreshed in our understanding of this important part of who we are and our worship experience. Ron and I were sitting the other night just talking about Eucharist and things of the Eucharist, and I was reminded by the Lord of my journey. I went to Bible college in 1978. I was 23 years old. When I went to Bible college, they told me I had to cut my hair, shave my beard, and act right. Now, I was already acting right, but the beard and the other stuff scared him, so. But I loved Bible college. I've laughed, I've told this story recently, that the whole thing about whether you have to wear a mask going to the store or whatever, that doesn't bother me at all. There are just bigger things that are more important to me. And if they told me I had to wear an aluminum foil hat with a propeller on top to be able to go to church, that's what I would do gladly. When I was in Bible college, the lifestyle I had lived before then was not typical to most of the people who were in Bible college there. And many of them had grown up in the church and knew all the songs that I didn't know. And the only song I knew, the only hymn I knew was, "Jesus loves me, this I know." By the time they were, as freshmen, most of them were like starry-eyed and inquisitive, but by the time they become like juniors, they're experts. And they become very critical. And back then, the Bible college I went to, they had real strict rules, like you could not have facial hair, freshmen couldn't, they had to double date, and they had a laundromat on campus. I never lived on campus, but you couldn't co-ed wash your clothes because they didn't want guys to see girls' undergarments. Their undergarments, and so it was very strict. And I remember hearing some of the juniors and seniors, because I was older, and the Lord kind of opened the door for me to speak in their life about some things, but they were complaining, kind of like planning a coup. It was nothing they could really do, but just about how ridiculous the rules were, and They were just griping and complaining. And I remember speaking to them and saying, I don't get it, guys. I said, where I've been, I said, I'm here. I'm hearing about Jesus every day. I'm learning about the Bible. There's this cool library, and I get to consume all these books that have this full of church history and great missionaries, great men and women of God. I said, and that's what I told them. I said, if they told me I had to wear an aluminum foil suit, I would gladly do that. I'm just grateful to be here. And I think God helped them a little bit. But in the process of being there, the library was my favorite part because it expanded beyond what I was learning in the classroom. I could just learn all kinds of stuff. And one of the things I began to learn in 1979 was about communion or Eucharist and how Eucharist was the centerpiece of worship from the very beginning. Even though different expressions of the church did it a little bit different, it just fascinated me. And the first time I went to a church service on Montclair Road near the Jewish Community Center in Birmingham was a little Brethren church, Plymouth Brethren, that met together. And in that service, what they did every week, they had a group of elders, and whatever elder showed up that day and said he had the word, that's what they did. But they passed around the little cups and they had Eucharist every week. That was my first experience to be in a church that did that every week. And I knew, because of the stuff I'd been reading, this is really significant. So it just caused me to want to learn more. And I realized I didn't understand everything about Eucharist, but I understood very clearly from early church writers and what the scripture said, from the history of the church for 2,000 years, that the vast majority, vast majority of believers had always believed that Eucharist was a centerpiece of genuine Christian worship. And there was not a single Christian anywhere until about the middle of the 16th century that believed any different. Now, the things I'm going to share with you a little bit, for those of you who may be newcomers and who haven't heard us talk about this stuff before, is that what I'm going to be sharing with you isn't from a Roman Catholic perspective. I'm not a Roman Catholic. I'm historically Catholic, but that's not Roman Catholic. If you believe the Bible and you believe what the church believed from the apostles on, then you're Catholic. But again, I'm not a Roman Catholic. I love Roman Catholics, but that's not who I am. And there was no such thing as a Roman Catholic church until the middle of the 16th century, the 1500s. But what I do when I teach about Eucharist, I'll do a few little quotes in the next week or two. Obviously, it's going to be over the next couple of weeks. I'm just going to do a few quotes. And all the quotes that I give like really close to the 100s, to 200 AD. Really close, because I want people to understand this is what the early church believed from the beginning. And a number of the ones I'm going to share were people who had relationships with and were discipled by some of the apostles, particularly the apostle John. Now, that's not going to be the dominant thing I do in terms of quoting early fathers, but the ones that I quote, I want you to understand who they are, where they came from, the timeline. But I think it's one of those words that we have to be reminded of if we're going to actually value this important part of who we are. I think it's important, too, because when this whole weird stuff started happening a few months ago, and I've reminded you of this before, that as we were just sort of hearing the Lord about what some practical things to do, one of the words that Chuck Pierce shared, who's someone I have a lot of respect for prophetically, was that one of the two things that were so significant for Christians to participate in regularly, if they're going to walk through this pandemic nonsense, this warfare, in a healthy spiritual way, was Eucharist, communion. And Chuck Pierce has just raised a nice Baptist boy and got filled with the Holy Spirit and has had nothing to do with what we would call Catholicism at all. And it's been interesting to me to watch other Christians people from places like Global and Bethel and IHOP, Mike Bickle, talk more and more over the years about the importance of communion and in some way or fashion make it available to their people. When Ron and I were out at IHOP, they make it available every single day because they believe there's something significant. So God's doing something in the church world about understanding the value of this as we engage in this cosmic conflict, and how God uses this amazing thing called Eucharist to help not just sustain us, but to nourish us spiritually so that we walk this out, not just this situation, but every situation victoriously. So let me read some verses to you, okay? Everybody hanging there with me? Those of you who wear the mask, honor you, but you need to get one that pictures a smiley face, because even if you don't like the sermon, I'll think that you do, and it'll be an encouragement to you. This is 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Now, this is what Paul said, and interesting that Paul says this, that what he understood about Eucharist was because he got a revelation from the Lord, not because anyone taught him. The same way he talked about the gospel. He said it was a revelation from God. So this is verse 23 of 1 Corinthians 11. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Now, just a couple of introductory statements. When he talks about doing this in remembrance of me, when he says, this is my body, do this in remembrance of me. This is my blood of the new covenant. Do this in remembrance of me. The words there, do this, is an imperative. An imperative means it's a command. It's not optional. And then it's also in the present tense. And present tense means continual action. That he's saying, this is something you should do as a command. It's that important to him, and it should be something that you do often and never stop doing it often. I remember years ago when I first moved to Selma and the church that I was at, one of the first things I did was we started having communion every Sunday night. And then when this church started, we started having Eucharist every Sunday morning. It's been that way all these years, for 40 years. So this journey for me has been a 41-year journey of discovering, and I never stopped discovering, the unsearchable riches of Christ. But I remember sometimes people would say, well, I don't want to take Eucharist every week because it won't seem as important to me. I'm going, well, therefore, you shouldn't read your Bible every day either because it won't be as important to you. One of the things I've always, in the early days, I had to help people get over Romophobia. It's a spiritual phobia that says if Roman Catholics do it, then I can't do it. Well, if they pray for people, then you can't do that anymore either. So we don't want to do that, right? All I know is that he says, as a command, as a continual way of life, you should partake in what we call the Eucharist or the Lord's Supper. Now, why? What's the big deal? That verse 26, it says, for as often as you eat this bread and you drink the cup, you proclaim, or the word would be announced loudly, actually, or you make a decree, a faith decree, a powerful faith decree. He says, as often as you drink this cup and eat this bread, you proclaim, you decree, you make present and decree the Lord's death until he comes. That's the big deal. That's the why. He's not just saying, as a memorial, we proclaim the fact that Jesus died. Now, this is happening, remember, in the context of the body of Christ coming together in worship. So if Eucharist is about just going, Jesus died on the cross, we all know that. It's much more than that. It's a prophetic declaration. It's a faith declaration, a strong one. And remember, the word remember, for those of you who don't know this, and many of you already do, it doesn't carry the idea of memorial. A memorial is for dead people, and Jesus is risen. And when he talks about his death, we decree his death until he comes again. When he speaks of the death or the cross, he's always speaking of the complete finished work of Christ. His death, resurrection, and ascension, and all that was accomplished. But the word remembrance is a fancy word, anamnesis. Anamnesis. And the word anamnesis doesn't mean to mentally recall. It's a unique Greek word that means to bring a past event present. And the event isn't repeated, but as if it's timeless. And every time you announce that or celebrate that, it's made present, and you're there as if you were there the first time it was going on. It's actually an eternal event made present in the time and space every time we make the declaration or the decree. So what's the past event made present? Calvary. When did Calvary happen? Before the foundation of the world. Manifested in time and space 2,000 years ago. But Jesus was a lamb slain before the foundation of the world. We've said this before. The answer was there before the problem ever came up. That's how God is. And the lamb slain before the foundation of the world is the answer. It is the victory of everything that was about to happen in the garden. And it's made manifest at Calvary. And so when we talk about anamnesis, we're saying that's an eternal event in the heart of God that was manifested in the natural 2,000 years ago. And every time we have Eucharist, Christ isn't re-crucified. If anybody ever teaches that, that's a heresy. For he died for our sins once and for all. But that event is made present so that we are able to experience it and enter into it as if we were there in the original eternal event. It's really important. So what's the big deal? The big deal is every time we celebrate Eucharist, the finished work of the cross, the victory of Calvary, over the reign of sin and evil is made present in a powerful way. And we're able to not just observe it, but participate in it. Use your imagination. God gave you one. So let's just say, if you're looking at the cross, if you were standing there at Calvary's Hill, and there's the cross, there's the broken body, there's the shed blood, and everything that that event accomplished in the destruction of the enemy and the making all things new, Jesus said that he bore our sorrow, he bore our sin, by his wound we were healed, he bore our grief, he bore our sickness, he made all things new. Stunning stuff. He accomplished your union with Christ. I mean, think about what it says in Galatians 2:20, I'm crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. What happened when he gave himself for me? I was crucified with Christ so that no longer I would live, but Christ would now live in me. That happened at the cross. Colossians 2 says, the finished work of Christ openly and in a humiliating way defeated the reign of sin, the enemy. When Jesus was buried, you know, we use the analogy of Lazarus, where at some point we're going to have to change that. Maybe when I finish these two Sundays and next Sunday, I'll talk about the grave clothes. But the grave clothes that Jesus wore were represented our grave clothes of our sin and our brokenness. And when John and Peter went and looked in, and they saw that the grave clothes were there, but not like in a wad or in a bundle. They were there, and the face cloths was laid over here, as if they were wrapped up just perfectly. Only thing was missing was the body. Amen. Jesus just slipped out of it supernaturally. And our grave clothes, our brokenness, the reign of sin over us, all those things, Jesus bore. He was wrapped up in those. He was skin tight. And when he slipped out of that, we slipped out of that. That's no longer who we are. Now I'm beginning to think we need to change Lazarus weekend to the empty tomb weekend. Because they went and they peeked in, and what they saw changed their life. Or we could call it sneak a peek weekend. Is that we help individuals to sneak a peek and see that the grave clothes they keep wanting to drag around has already been left behind. They slipped out of them in Christ. It's a remarkable thing. The old man's gone. So think about all that was accomplished at the cross in every Eucharist. When we proclaim his death, that reality is made present. So when you think about Jesus on the cross, say you're there 2,000 years ago, but you will be there, of course, again today. Or I'll tell you what, better than that. There's going to be here. How about that? There's going to be here. And you have God provided you a lounge chair for the event. I mean, here you are. But now this is silly, but so go with me here, my silliness. So like you see all that and you realize this is his broken body, there's his shed blood, and all the things, that the freedom, the making all things new, the birthing of the reign of Christ, the reign of the kingdom, your union with Jesus now has your life, all those cool things. Remember what the gospel is? We've been saying this a lot lately from Galatians. So hear me again about what grace. There are good definitions of grace, but I got a new one. Because you can't separate grace from the gospel. It's this. Because of the cross, your inclusion into the life that Jesus lives and the favor that he lives under. If you're prepared to praise him, even when things don't seem to be working out yet, you can't see it. If you're prepared to praise him in the darkness, then you and I, all of us, need to take that truth out to a spin and begin to expect to live and experience the same favor that Jesus lives under. If I've been included in the life he lives, then I should know the favor he has. That's the gospel. So if you understood all that, the defeat of the enemy, your union with Christ, his favor accomplished for you, bore your sin, bore your sickness, bore your sorrow, the reign of sin over you been broken. It's there on the cross, and it was made out of gingerbread, dripping with strawberry syrup. What would you do? I would go and consume it. It says about Eucharist in 1 Corinthians 5, 7, 8. Let me just read it to you better than me getting part of it wrong. For Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed for us. Let us therefore celebrate the feast. That's what we do. Every time we have Eucharist, we feast on the finished work of Christ in a sort of condensed way. Don't we feast on that every day? Don't we celebrate and enjoy the benefits of the finished work of Christ every day? Yes. But there's something about Eucharist that makes it so incarnationally present, so practically present. It's as if we're experiencing the finished work of Christ on a booster level. You with me? At a concentrated level. The word Eucharist, we use the word Eucharist to mean Thanksgiving, but it carries more weight than that. It comes from two words. One of the words is well-being. Not just good, like, oh, this is good. No, it brings goodness. It brings well-being. And the other word's grace. But most of the time it's translated as thanksgiving. But the idea of Eucharist, the word Eucharist, is to be thankful for how good God's grace is. And the word charis that grace comes from also gives birth to the word chara, which means joy. So let me give you a literal meaning of what Eucharist, the word Eucharist, actually means. It's an acknowledgement of God's beneficial grace that results in great joy. That's what Eucharist is. Coming forth and giving thanks for God's beneficial grace that's mine because of the finished work of Christ that's resulted in such great joy in my life. That's Eucharist. It's a celebration of thanksgiving. It's a celebration of acknowledging that the cross has changed everything. That I'm a new creation because of the cross. That the reign of sin has been broken because of the cross. That I have life and life more abundant because I'm in Christ because of the cross. See, also in Eucharist, if you think about the only person who wrote about this and was John, is that in the context of the first Lord's Supper, the Eucharist, after washing their feet, John put his head on the breast of Christ. And it's there John heard the heartbeat of Jesus. That's there he heard the heartbeat of God. And that's why when all the disciples abandoned Jesus at the cross, John came back. You see, because I believe when John heard the heartbeat of God in the chest of Christ, he saw the cross. And at every Eucharist, we get to lay our head on the breast of Jesus and hear the heartbeat of the cross that changed everything. That's bigger than coronavirus. That's bigger than economics. That's bigger than anything else. For if by the transgressions of the one, death reigned through the one, much more, those who receive the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness shall reign in life through the one Christ Jesus. That's what every Eucharist is about, and we feast on that in a condensed way, in a concentrated way. At every Eucharist. When we receive Eucharist, we nourish ourselves on a highly concentrated level on the presence of Jesus and his finished work. It's a booster shot of the finished work of Christ. Those of you around years ago, we taught this over months, a period of months. What Scripture makes very clear, what the church has decreed and declared for 2,000 years, is that it's the serpent's anti-venom and it's death's antidote. The serpent nips at our heels all day long, and we walk in the victory that's ours in Christ. But in Eucharist, we get a booster shot of the victory of Jesus we partake of the serpent's anti-venom. Remember what we said, that eternal life isn't about going to heaven one day. It's about going to heaven the moment you became a Christian, or actually heaven coming to you. Eternal life, the word eternal just is the word ages. It just means ion. It's the word ages. Hebrews talks about the fact that we've partaken of the life of the age to come. The supernatural, heavenly life that's ours in Christ. It's the age to come life. And every time we receive Eucharist, we take a big, huge bite of the age to come life. We take a big, huge bite of that what's called eternal life, the life that Jesus is, the supernatural life that he carries. Don't I have that every day? Yes, you do. But in Eucharist, in every Eucharist, we get to take a big bite of it in a fresh way, an extra dose. Why do you do it that way? Because we do live in a world of cosmic conflict. You say, well, this sounds like fairy tale stuff to me. The cross sounds like fairy tale stuff to me. When I led my nephew Brent to Christ, he was 3 years old, I said, Jesus wants to come and live in your heart. And he said, Uncle Chuck, is he going to climb on a ladder and get real small and climb up into my heart? And I thought, kind of. Eucharist is a mystery. Eucharist is glorious mystery. Eucharist, things like Eucharist and signs and wonders, things like that lift Christianity out of gray on gray. There's something supernatural, otherworldly. That's why C.S. Lewis's book was so powerful. It drew us into the reality that the kingdom of heaven's not like what we're used to. It's something bigger. It's something brighter. There's something in a holy way magical about it. And Jesus said over and over again, this is the bread which comes down from heaven. So, wow, citizens of heaven come together in a corporate way, sing the songs of our homeland, release the gifts of the Spirit, the signs and wonders of the homeland, because it's a supernatural ages to come life that we get to participate in. And then we eat the food of the homeland, which is the finished work of Christ on the cross. And then at the end we go, now, go forth into all the world, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. So, don't get legalistic on me, because I can't come up with a better word than magical. Maybe it's supernatural. That'd be better. Supernatural food from a supernatural place to help enhance us living the supernatural life that's ours in Christ. But it's all about the finished work of Christ at the cross. See, like, I like brownies, which is a curse because for 4.5 years I can't eat brownies. But what I'll do is I'll nibble on a brownie. It may take me days to finish it, but somehow it doesn't seem as bad, like I'm cheating. But one of the things I've done during coronavirus is I've probably both, Bezos' wealth has probably increased triple because I just keep pushing that button, Amazon Prime. And it makes life so good because I know Christmas is here tomorrow and the next day because it shows up at my front door, packed up in an Amazon Prime box. I've had sauerkraut come. I've had all kinds of stuff. But one of the ones I saw was the world's fudgiest brownie. I thought, wow. Wow. I briefly checked with the Lord to see if it was okay for me to order it. And by the time he answered, I'd already pushed it go. And there's no reversing. But it is. It's the fudgiest brownie I've ever eaten in my entire life. And Henry, my dog, would say amen to that. So there's brownies, you know? Like every day, I enjoy the brownies of my life in Christ. But when you have Eucharist, it's like brownies on steroids. It's like you get this Jesus steroid shot that helps you experience Jesus as you go out. So again, what's the gospel? Because of the cross, our inclusion into the life that Jesus lives and the favor that he lives under. Now, I'm going to say that phrase a lot in the weeks and the months ahead because I want us to expand our imagination and dare to go after that. But we can't if you're not willing to praise him in the darkness. You hear me? If we're willing to praise him in the darkness and his goodness never be on trial, let's go after that. That's why five different times in the Upper Room Discourse, Jesus said, if anything you ask in my name, I'll do it for you. What? What? That's living under his favor. But don't we have to get perfect enough for that to happen? Don't we have to get perfect enough? This is the whole, we're doing Galatians on Wednesday night. Don't I have to perfect myself enough to where I've postured myself to earn that? No. What Jesus did was perfect on the cross. And in his perfect work, he postured us to experience that. And in experiencing that, you're transformed. I'm too old to put it off. You with me? When I go to heaven, it's just the fudgiest brownies we ever lived, ever was, all the time. I want to experience as much as I can. And Eucharist matters because it nourishes my union with Christ. As a matter of fact, it says in John 6, he says, verse 56, he who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me and I in him. That's true all the time, right? Yes. But something about Eucharist, because it's the cross made present that I get to feed on, that nourishes that and strengthens my experience of that, which makes a difference in my walking things out in Christ. It's a fresh and concentrated infusion of the victory of Christ on our behalf. One of the early fathers, Ignatius, called it the medicine of immortality. It's, remember, those of you, how many of you love the, like, the Lion, Witch, and Wardrobe? So raise your hand if you're one of the, one of the real significant parts of the Lion, Witch, and Wardrobe was Lucy's vial. The juice of the fire flower, it was red. And if she would, and after that battle, wherever someone was wounded, even dying, if she put a few drops in their mouth, they came alive. That was about Eucharist. That was Lewis's heart. That's what the point he was trying to make. That we do have battle and we do get wounded. We walk it out and a serpent nips at our heels and yet we gather together. The army gathers together among fellow citizens of heaven and we creatures of heaven get to eat bread from heaven and there's healing in it. I'll read this one thing and then we'll stop and go back next week. I'll read you two little quick things. This is from St. John Chrysostom. His nickname was Golden Mouth. He was considered the greatest preacher in church history. How many are they who say, how should I have wished to see the fair presence of his form physically? His figure, his clothes, Jesus' shoes. Why, here you see him. And while you are longing to see his clothes, he gives you himself not only to look at, but to touch and to feast on and to receive within you. One of the great early fathers, Irenaeus, said this. I'll just read the last part. He causes our blood to flow and the bread as part of creation. He has established his own body from which he gives increase to our bodies. And the early fathers and mother said those kind of things over and over again. Not only was your soul nourished, but your very body was nourished. Because the enemy attacks us on the inside out, doesn't he? All righty, we'll stop. Next week we'll look at John 6 a little more. But I want us to be reminded that we're in a supernatural battle. And God has done some amazing, cool stuff. See, the most that provides for us, not only, Eucharist, here's the cool thing, Eucharist is the most charismatic thing I do. To believe that bread and wine become the body and blood of Jesus, becomes that body, that blood that was there 2,000 years ago. And he doesn't just say, gaze on me, how wonderful. He says, feast on that and all the life that it brings. When we ring those bells, we're ringing the bells to inform you, whoa, wake up. This isn't about a formula. There's a miracle taking place. The cross is now coming into view. The finished work is here. Calvary's here. Feast on it. You see, it's actually the cross that's the antivenom, and the cross is the antidote. And the Eucharist simply is the means. That's what sacrament does. That makes the cross and all the cross accomplished on our behalf uniquely here and something that we get to feast on. Amen. Well, we'll go at it again next week. But we've talked about the feast long enough. Amen? Let's do the feast. All righty. Let's stand together. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Share the sign of God's peace with one another. We'll make the formal introduction, but this is Father Chuck, actually Canon Chuck Shores, his wife Nancy, and they are, I like to use the word Selminians instead of Selmian, because Selminian seems more otherworldly. It sort of more fits our destiny as the kingdom of heaven. So these are our newest Selminians, and they're part of who we are. Amen. Amen. So again today, if you have need for healing, when you receive Eucharist, you come to this altar rail. And the people that will be praying for you will be wearing masks. Okay? And if you don't need healing prayer, then you come to this altar rail to receive Eucharist. Okay? No, because we do this. Yeah, well, once you just get your Eucharist and go. If you come over here, you receive Eucharist and go back to your seat. Eventually, we're going to change back over to what we're doing on Wednesdays, which is not what we used to do yet, but it's still very, very safe. It makes more sense. But if you receive Eucharist and you need prayer for healing, then you come to this altar rail and we're praying for you, okay? And we trust that you'll be healed since you already were. Well, blessed to you, Lord God, King of all creation. Through goodness we have his bread to offer, which earth has given, human hands have made, it will become the body of Christ.
Blessed be God forever.
The mixing of this water and this wine, may we come to share in the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share in our humanity. Blessed to you, Lord God, King of all creation. Through your goodness we have this wine to offer. Fruit of the vine and work of human hands will become the blood of Christ.
Blessed be God forever.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks, Lord our God.
It
is right. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for the gift of Eucharist that we get to just participate in fresh, personal, concentrated way. The finished work of Christ at the cross. We get to lay our head on your breast and hear the love of God that so gave his Son. We bless you, Lord. Praise you. Joining our voices with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Lord, you're holy indeed, the fountain of all holiness. Let your Holy Spirit come upon these gifts to make them holy. They may become the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Before he was given up to death, a death he freely accepted, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." When supper was ended, he took the cup, and again he gave you thanks and praise. He gave the cup to his disciples, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for the whole world, for the forgiveness of sins, for the healing of fallen and broken humanity. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Let us therefore proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. Father, we thank you for the Alabama Awakening. We praise you for the Selma Revival. We call it forth to full maturity. Here at the foot of the cross, we just plead the blood of Jesus against this pandemic. We command the pandemic to bow its knee to the Lordship of Jesus. We command it to flee, to run, to disappear. Lord, draw our hearts from the poor and the broken. To receive the body and the blood of Jesus, may we be transformed to become the body of Christ of the world. Have mercy on us, O Lord. If you have made us worthy, share eternal life with all the saints. May we praise you in union with them and give you glory through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Now as our Savior Christ has taught us, we're bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Hallelujah, Christ our Passover sacrifice for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you've taken away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you've taken away the sins of the world, grant us your peace. Behold God's love for you. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are those who are called the marriage supper of the Lamb. Lord, we praise you. In these holy gifts, there is healing for body, soul, and spirit.
How quickly we forget the God who lives in every day. How easy to lose sight that you reside in the mundane. How quickly we forget the power that's running through our veins. The kind of power that
we're going to do is, again, if you pray for healing, come here. If not, go there. Also, Laura, you and Nikki, when y'all come and receive, and then you guys come up here and pray for people on live stream for healing. If you guys wouldn't mind doing that.
That's the God who walks with you. And all my soul, you know that he did it then. He can do it all again. His power can still raise the dead. Don't tell me that he's finished yet. This will not forget the voice. Displace all your fears, brilliant as the sun, he won't delay. A perfect love is on its way.
Who's struggling with a hip problem, a right hip, and also with addiction.
May all those watching live stream, let the seeds planted today grow to full fruition in your life. Enjoy the power and the presence of Jesus Christ as he reigns holy in your life. I ask these things in Jesus' name.
And Lord, we speak to that hip, and we tell you to come into alignment with what the Father has and what he has said, his word for you, and that is complete healing, that you walk in healing. And I speak to that hip, and I say, you come into alignment with what the Father says. We speak and we claim healing in it right now, Father. And we speak to addiction, whoever is struggling with addiction, and we tell you the addiction must go. We speak to you, addiction, and tell you you have no room and no authority in this person's life, and we claim healing over that. And we thank you, Father.
Again, if you have need for healing, this would be a good, great day in light of what we talked about. So put these dear folks to work over here. there's someone on live stream who's got some issue, pretty serious arthritis in your left knee. Those prayers that went forth, there's a really particular grace that see you healed. Someone who's just been diagnosed within the last 3 weeks of cancer. I think it's got something in this area of your body, so I don't know if it's, I'm not sure, but I just believe that God gave that word so that you would experience healing. So if that was you, receive the healing. Also, there's someone watching who you drive a truck that's got a lot of green in it. I don't think it's solid green. Got a lot of green, and you had some kind of accident in the last year, and you've had some hip issues since then. And we're just believing God for your healing. Amen. There's also some people on live stream who are really longing to be filled with the Holy Spirit, but you've been reluctant, you've been afraid. If you're home by yourself, then I want you to simply do this. I'm going to pray for you that you'll be baptized in the Holy Spirit, and then in the privacy of your own home, I want you to open your mouth and start praising God, but not in English. Very simple. Okay? I'm going to pray for you to be baptized in the Spirit. And then after I do, I want you to open your mouth and intentionally by faith start praising God, but not in English. Father, I just thank you that Jesus, you're the baptizer. So I just pray that you would baptize those who are longing, desire to see the release, their immersion into the life that Christ is and the life that Jesus lives in them. Baptize them in the Holy Spirit, oh God. Totally immerse them. Saturate every cell in the wonders of the Holy Spirit who makes your life, Jesus, real in us. So just receive. And again, just open your mouth, start praising God, but not in English. I just keep getting this image of someone watching and your grandmother is there in the home. She's got something going on physically. If you'll just get up from where you are, walk over and pray for your grandmother, God's going to heal her. Let's the rest of us stand together. Eternal God and Heavenly Father, you've graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. You fed us with spiritual food and the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace. Grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. St. Michael the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, Prince of the Heavenly Host, by the divine power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who roam throughout Selma and the whole world, seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. Well, as we leave this place, my prayer is that each one of us, knowing who you are in Christ, would go forth into the world, manifesting the fullness of Jesus everywhere you go and to everyone you meet. And that you'll keep your spiritual eyes open and you'll sniff out demonic oppression. And when you do, in Jesus' name, do something about it. May the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you, remain with you now and forever. Amen.
Okay.